Our next guest is investigative reporter Steve Horn, whose work has exposed the common threads between climate denialism and anti-stay-at-home protest movements. Unsurprisingly, it's conservative groups and individuals who are invested in climate-killing corporations and companies whose workers could become deathly ill from the pandemic. But they don't care about them, clearly, nor the people they are sending out to protest in order to protect their billions. Steve Horn is joining us. He is a California-based climate reporter and producer for the Real News Network, freelance investigative reporter. His work has also appeared in The Intercept, The Guardian, Al Jazeera America, Vice, Wisconsin Watch, Counterpunch Magazine, Truth Out, TYT Investigates, and on the Giuliana Forlano Show on Pacifica, and now here on ACT TV. Steve, thanks for joining us. I appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks for having me. It's, yeah, like you said, it's been a while, but looking forward to talking to you. And thanks for having me.
Okay. Yeah, no, my pleasure. Your reporting found that some of the same groups that are backing these protests of the stay-at-home orders are the ones promoting climate denialism. Can you talk about who these groups are and what their interests are?
Yes. So I think that it's important to point out that it's not only the groups themselves, but it's also the techniques. So I'll start with the techniques real quickly, just for an overview to see the parallels between climate denialism and COVID-19, either denialism or, as it's moved today, to not so much straight up denialism, although that still exists, but denial, sort of like a downplaying. And that's really the parallel here, is that we first saw that it was compared to the flu and that it was being overblown and that it wasn't really that big of a deal in the United States. It's, you know, through Trump and through various other conservative vessels of that message. And then it has morphed to, it has evolved all the way to now that it's, yes, it's a problem, but is the cure worse than the disease, if it's sort of the new expression that they're using.
Andrew Cuomo was so great when he said, the disease is death.
Yeah, exactly. And then they'll say, you know, just real quick, they'll say, well, maybe the disease is depression, or maybe the disease, you know, looking at their arguments, or maybe it's a potential suicide. I mean, I think that the bottom line is to sort of like look at this just big picture. They're still, depending on the poll, even conservatives, over half of conservatives still support these stay-at-home orders. And then if you look at like the aggregate of the country, it's upwards of 70-80% in a lot of polls of people that support this. So when we're talking about, I'm about to jump into, is who's behind these and who's backing these protests, it's important to keep in mind that that does not represent even close to the majority of the country, even within, and not even the majority of conservatives. So that's important to point out. And
you just made me feel a lot better, because I felt like I was living in crazy town.
I thought that maybe it would tip the scales more, but even as these polls are as of a few days ago. So I mean, it's not, these protests aren't exactly completely like, you know, revolutionizing people's thoughts on this. People are still really worried about this on both the Republican and Democratic sides, according to several polls. So that said, who are the groups behind these? Well, in a lot of cases, it's not the groups that are actually pushing people out into the streets. It's more like the echo chamber that they've helped create to lift this message, to make it something that the media wants to cover, to make it seem like maybe a little bit bigger than it actually is. But at least in one case, I think it's important to look at Michigan, because that was the first really big one. And I give the media a lot of credit. They did find this connection before me, but I just kind of lifted it up and looked at a few other like supporting connections to it that they may not have realized. But basically, there's many stories that arose after the Michigan protests that said that, look, the group that called for this particular protest, which was, I think, the biggest so far, it was about 2,000 to 3,000 people at the Michigan Capitol.
Maskless people.
Yeah, maskless. Well, yeah, exactly. I mean, Trump has said, oh, well, they've been 6 feet apart, and that they weren't 6 feet apart if you look at any of the pictures of that protest. But that was a group that is heavily, you know, mostly financed by the DeVos Family Foundation. So Betsy DeVos is our United States Secretary of Education right now, and her family, before she became Secretary of Education, as probably a lot of watchers know, they are very heavily involved in right-wing philanthropy, and especially on education, but not only education issues. And what I found So that was reported already. What I pointed to is the fact that another group that she and her family foundation backs, and this is the, by the way, the Amway Corporation Fortune is who the DeVos family is and how they got.
Really? Wow. Yeah. I did not know that.
Amway. Yeah. The pyramid scheme company. Yikes. Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah. And her, by the way, just real quick aside, her brother is Eric Prince, who was the,
oh no.
Yeah. So that's the Prince.
Tell the people, I know who that is, but maybe
yeah. Eric knows. Prince is the former CEO of Blackwater Corporation, which was a huge private mercenary company, in particular during the Bush era, which had upwards of 100,000 plus private mercenaries that were being sent to, in particular, Iraq during the Iraq War. And they committed, you know, some war crimes, or it would have been war crimes if it was U.S. troops, that ended up being prosecuted, some of their mercenaries, for in federal court for those crimes that they committed. But yeah, I mean, it was extremely, wow. Yeah, and Prince was part of
the private armies. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he still has some in other countries. You know,
what's he up to these days?
Well, that's important to point out. So he was involved in the 2016 Trump campaign, and he is still sort of in that the Trump orbit. And he was very close with Steve Bannon. He used to be a frequent guest on Steve Bannon's show when he was with Breitbart News. And I'll talk about Breitbart has a really key role in Michigan, so that's actually a good transition. So perfect segue, really. So this particular protest was promoted first of all, it was called by this thing called the Michigan Freedom Fund, which is DeVos funded, and that's where a lot of the money comes from. The executive director of that is a guy by the name of Greg McNeely, who is a close confidant of the DeVos family and ran Dick DeVos's campaign for governor when he ran many years ago. But so he's been a longtime aide and inner circle of the family's business and foundation and nonprofit endeavors. But what I think was important, where the Breitbart connection comes in, is there's another group in Michigan called the Mackinac Public Policy Center. And Mackinac is part of this national organization called the State Policy Network, which is all of these kind of groups like this. They're not standalone groups in the conservative world. They are part of something called the SPN, or the State Policy Network, which is actually, I wrote about my story, I covered this back in 2013. It was a creation, actually, of the American Legislative Exchange Council. So ALEC.
ALEC. Yes, everyone knows ALEC, right? ALEC is, and so they needed another name, ALEC by another name.
It is ALEC, it's basically ALEC's messaging force to give their bills like a scholarly veneer or a think tank veneer. So there's these think tanks all around the country, or as where I used to work, there was the Center for Media Democracy. We put out a report called Stink Tanks. It's basically where does this messaging come from, basically? And the State Policy Network is really important to understand. So Mackinac is part of that. DeVos funds SPN. They're not the only funder. The Koch brothers funded several many corporations have funded it throughout history, like ExxonMobil. But yeah, SPN and going back
so
to
they're
that,
not hurting for cash is what you're telling
they're
me.
They're definitely not hurting for cash. And
do you think is there any evidence that the protesters are paid?
No, but I think that they're useful in this broader machine's effort. But no, I do not think that there's any evidence of that yet. I think that the people who are actually protesting are true believers in the cause, who have definitely been riled up by this network to go and do what they've done. So this network is kind of quietly doing, not even quietly, I mean, they're doing stuff on social media and writing about it and using their means of communication to bolster the message, for sure. But
in our chat says they're useful idiots, not paid idiots.
Yeah, I think that would be or you could say COVID idiots if you're going with the hashtag. Yeah, but yeah. So just real quick, the last thing I'll say about this is that so the Mackinac Public Policy Center, which is part of the SPN, the State Policy Network, they have a kind of a their own news network called Michigan Capital Confidential. So they were covering this as it happened, and in their at least one or two of their stories, they were pointing to a live feed that Breitbart was doing. So Breitbart was there in Michigan covering this first thing. And what's crazy is that the Breitbart video, as of my reporting, which was last week, had 5.8 million viewers. So just immense. They have like an immense reach on Breitbart. And Breitbart, the way this all ties together is Breitbart is, at least was heavily financed by the Mercer Family Foundation, who also funds this whole network that we've been talking about. Robert Mercer was kind of the man behind the scenes, the billionaire who helped Trump get to office, who, of course, that's the Breitbart connection. That's the Steve Bannon connection. So, I mean, in a lot of ways, like, I was not surprised. Once you see it this way, it's not as surprising that on the same day as this Michigan protest happened, or maybe it was the day after, but within, you know, a short period of time, Trump was doing the whole liberate Michigan, liberate this day. I mean, I think that this is definitely an intertwined network that ties right back to President Trump and his administration.
So could it be said that President Trump is complicit in orchestrating these protests?
He has definitely, at the very least, and not even a dog whistle, he's definitely done the blow horn, that basically like saying that he supports these protests through his Twitter. I mean, that's the whole thing that Trump does, is on social media, he's reaching out to his base. And then in these daily press briefings, he's, you could say, slightly more reasonable, but still insane, but kind of more cautious in the way that he talks about things from a Trump standard. But I think that, yeah, I think you could definitely call him complicit in all of this, all the way back from the beginning of downplaying it and calling it the flu. And
he's telling people to drink bleach.
Exactly. And I mean, he at the very beginning of when he's running for president, at least, I don't know how much he's talked about climate change recently, but just to parallel it, I mean, he's called climate change a quote unquote hoax as well. I think at one point he was even calling it a Chinese hoax. So that even in some ways, it's a weird parallel to all of this, because he's calling him and his followers have at some points called it and still are calling it the China virus. So yeah.
Can you talk about more specifically about the common thread between this denialism and, you know, resisting life-saving stay-at-home measures?
Sure. Yeah. I mean, I think the important part about this is that these groups are, yeah, so I talked about who the groups are, but all these groups, whether it's in Michigan or, as my article pointed out, Idaho or North Carolina, all the groups in this network, they're not only calling for a hastening of ending the stay-at-home orders, they all have track records of denying climate change, basically. And so I think that that's important to point out, is that on these huge issues of the day that will, you know, climate change is already killing people in some cases. If you look at the wildfires in California, or you look at super hurricanes, you look at what happened in Puerto Rico. So these things that are literally killing people in both cases, they've downplayed or denied. And I think that's definitely the common thread. So I'll just give an example. Like in Idaho, it's so extreme that the group that called for protesting the Idaho Freedom Foundation, and they had a smaller action, but still decent size in Idaho at their capital. That group, which is also part of the State Policy Network, another common thread of all this, they earlier this year in January were through the state's education bureaucracy, were actually advocating that climate change in K-12 schools be taught, not just so climate change is real and it's this big civilizational threat. They actually were calling for a balanced education on climate change. So we teach both sides, if you will.
Climate change is a real existential threat according to science, and it's also fine. Nothing's happening, according
exactly.
to
that. Yeah. And this, I mean, yeah, just to like point to that for a second, that's not like within this orbit of this world, that is something that they have pushed for decades through ALEC and through other channels. But yeah, so I mean, it wasn't like the first time that this has happened or anything, but it does show the parallel for sure between the two issues of COVID-19 and what they're doing on that and through climate change or climate denial.
Do you have any evidence that people are starting to see through these sort of planned nationalist uprisings over the most ridiculous things?
Well, I think that it was pretty, it was I think unlike the Tea Party, we'll say, and that's another good historical parallel, Tea Party, which was over a decade ago now when it started. And I think that back then there was less knowledge in even like the mainstream media, even maybe in the progressive media, about the Koch network and the funding behind the right wing. So it kind of seemed more spontaneous back then, at least from what I remember. It took a while for the media to catch up to that. And by that time, it was just being called like a backlash against Obama and a backlash against the, which would have been the Obamacare back then and the cap and trade bill. I think now, right away, there's been skepticism and reporting on who some of the backers of this are, what they're saying. And just that knowledge that's built up over the years, seeing like the Koch brothers in action and seeing this Koch allied network in action. But yeah, another interesting thing though, I want to say something about the Koch brothers actually. And I mean, there's only one main.
There's only one Koch brother now.
Yeah, exactly. But the they're
took forever.
Yeah. Yeah. So I guess it would now be the Charles Koch led network, but they actually, the stuff that's happening today that we're talking about through the Koch network, they actually do not support what's happening. So the Americans for Prosperity, which is their main national network, they have not gotten behind this, and they've said explicitly that basically they're kind of in line with keeping the protections in place, stay at home,
because they're old.
Yeah,
they're old and they don't want to die. That's
but also the way that I see it is like they helped create this machine and this monster, and I think that even in some ways that they're a little bit horrified about the end result. Like they also did not support Donald Trump for president back in 2016.
Well, you think they could have done something with all that money and networking to, you know, fight against this. But yes, how they did not see that they were unleashing the forces of this Pandora's box, I guess will be something that historians can look into. You know, these big wealthy groups and individuals that are out to preserve their own wealth, what about the people who are listening to them? These people have real grievances. Mm-hmm. Is there a way to reach these folks to channel that energy against a government that's supporting corporations instead of against, you know, workers like them?
Yeah, that's an absolutely essential point to bring up, is that these people do have real grievances, and they're huge worries right now with what's happening in the economy. And so a lot of it is just a gut reaction. They're really worried about their livelihoods. And that's the same thing like back during the Tea Party, the people who were involved. I think that the liberals had a kind of propensity just to write them off as sort of lunatics and what's, you know, sort of what's their deal? What's with these
people? Yes, and here we are.
Here we are. But also
to President Sanders dealing with this crisis.
Yeah, exactly. But that's the thing. It's sort of this tinderbox situation. And back then, I remember hearing a lecture in Madison, Wisconsin, where I live. Noam Chomsky was saying that they had real grievances and that should be listened to, and that's a perfect point by you. If they're not tapped into by progressive forces, then reactionary forces will move these people, and exactly here we are, like here. And so I think that to bring it to today, the troubling thing is that within the Democratic Party nationally, and probably in a lot of states as well, basically, there aren't really adequate protections being put into place for people who are losing their jobs and their livelihoods. And that's the real problem. If people feel like they don't have that, then they really are going to probably more and more start pushing to reopen the economy before it's actually safe to do so. So I think that in a lot of ways, so far, it's been the failure of, and it's been a bipartisan failure, obviously, because it's Republicans as well who have the power in Washington. But it's been the bipartisan failure, really, to move forward on a recovery package that would really truly help the people who are really hurting right now. And basically in this Great Depression that we are kind of fastly approaching.
We're speaking with Steve Horn of the Real News Network and independent journalist, published in all the good outlets. Will these groups win the ideological battle around climate change and the coronavirus, or will the scientists and journalists, will we be able to overcome that cynicism? What are your thoughts about that?
I think that the groups are, I think a lot of it depends on what happens with the response, like we were just discussing. Like over time, I think that so far it's still pretty marginal in terms of the uptake of this on COVID-19 and reopening the economy. But if the response is like seen as inadequate moving forward, I think there'll be more and more people clamoring for reopening before it's safe to, you know, before scientists say it's safe.
But then at some point, won't the reopening then cause an explosion of disease? And then won't they notice, you know, that that's a problem?
Yeah, wave two. Yeah, most likely. Yeah. So
I know someone in our chat said something about how with the Spanish flu, wave two and wave three were even more virulent than the first wave.
It absolutely. Yeah. That's the point I was making. And that's a essential point to make. And then in terms of climate, actually, even that has shifted over time. So if you look at polling, I haven't seen polling from like 10 or 20 years ago, but I'm guessing that it was more divided among liberals and conservatives. But actually, if you look at polling as of like the past year and a half, that especially the George Mason University has been doing through their climate polling center that they have there, climate communications. Basically, it's actually a lot more conservatives believe that climate change, and especially younger conservatives believe that climate change is a pressing concern and something that we need to do something about. So it's definitely, I think that, you know, just like a lot of issues, there's a divide between young and old people. But I do think that even among conservative people, I wouldn't say that's like their number one issue that they're fighting for, but there's definitely at least belief that it's a real issue and that it's something that we have to act upon.
Steve, you're working on a few other pieces. Can you give us a little, give us a taste of what's coming out?
Sure. Well, I think that, you know, May Day is coming up. And one of the things that I've been following and tracking and doing some reporting on is how has this affected workers in the energy sector? So that could be oil, gas, coal. It could also mean wind. How is COVID impacting their day-to-day work lives, and what's the energy industry doing about it? So there'll be something out this week on The Real News about that.
Do you see any, in your reporting so far on this, do you see any openings for a clean energy revolution here that people are hoping for?
There's definitely a hope among the sort of the Green New Deal section of the climate movement. They're calling for a green stimulus right now. So a $1 billion package, basically, to start out with. That wouldn't be the whole Green New Deal, but it would be sort of plant the seeds of a Green New Deal in response to this, rather than what has been happening. The Trump administration has been doing is giving or offering various bailouts or deregulatory measures so far to help especially the oil industry, which is doing terribly right now with the tanking global oil price, which actually last week reached below zero, the first time in history, which is that's the call for among, and I think there'll be increasingly a call for that among the climate movement moving forward. And actually, I'll be curious to see what someone like Joe Biden, what does he have to say about the green stimulus? Of course, the Obama administration passed their own it was less money than that, but their own green stimulus during the recovery era after the 2008-2009 recession. So there's definitely precedent for this. So I'll be curious what you know, how the green stimulus translate into Biden's policy package in the days and weeks ahead.
Well, Steve, it's great to have you back on my program here, and I look forward to having you back on in the future. Thanks again for coming on. I appreciate it.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me.
No problem. We're speaking with Steve Horn, climate reporter and producer for the Real News Network. You can find and follow Steve on the Twitters at Steve A. Horn, H-O-R-N, spelled exactly like you think. Thanks a lot, Steve. We'll catch you.
Thanks a lot. Take care.